Germany boasts a treasure trove of over 2500 enchanting castles, each with its own unique history and charm. Among them stands the iconic Neuschwanstein Castle in Bavaria, renowned worldwide as the inspiration behind countless fantasy stories and even Disney's magical castles. Ironically, Neuschwanstein itself is a product of fantasy. The castle was built just over 150 years ago by King Ludwig II of Bavaria, often dubbed as the Mad. Castles all over the world served as an inspiration for Neuschwanstein Castle, so join me as we unravel tales of castle builders from antiquity to modernity. We explore the motivations and reasons that led them to erect these majestic buildings and talk about what made them so formidable in defense and magnificent in design. Just so we can revisit Ludwig's tale at the end of the video and prompt you the questions to help design the perfect castles and palaces for your own world-building project. But first, I'm going to make you think about Rome for a second. In September of the year 52 BC, Julius Caesar, serving as governor of Gaul, laid siege to Alesia, the last stronghold of the Gallic Confederation of Tribes, resisting Roman rule. As a part of the siege, Caesar constructed a massive wall to encircle the city, so nobody gets in or out. However, Caesar got wind of a relief army of Gauls coming to the aid of the besieged people in Alesia. Fearing a catastrophic defeat, Caesar built a second set of walls as a method to fortify his besieging position. The Romans were famous for their castle construction. Their architects and engineers were able to build marching camps within hours and constructed countless more permanent fortifications along the border of the empire. Among them, the famous Hadrian's Wall or the Germanic Limes. Cities like Cologne, Strasbourg, and York were the result of the vibrant commercial and social life that sprung out in and around the largest of the legionary camps. In general, these fortifications that are called castra in Latin had the same structure more or less. The uniform nature of the camps allowed for an efficient construction no matter where you are in the large empire. Everyone from legionary to engineer knew what to do, but this design shouldn't last forever. As the empire was waning, the emperors enacted countless military reforms to make the military more efficient with the fleeting resources and the increasing threats they faced. Their reforms also included their castles, which became more pragmatic, less of a sheer show of force. The Romans took the environment more into account, and the larger camps that turned into cities at that point were cut in size in favor for more flexible auxiliary camps along the border. But not unlike the Germanic tribes exploiting the holes in the Roman defenses centuries after Caesar's death, the Gauls did the same in Alesia. The Gauls began their attack on the weakened position in the north where two legions were encamped. This attack cost many Roman lives, but due to Roman discipline, they prevailed and defeated the Gauls and their leader Vercingetorix. True medieval castles shouldn't emerge until way after the fall of the Western Roman Empire, however. Three centuries after the fall of Western Rome, a Viking named Reginherus, who is believed to be the legendary figure Ragnar Lodbrok, launched an attack on the city of Paris with his mighty fleet. The city withstood the attacks and the fleet left, but not until the Frankish King Charles the Bald paid a ransom of 7,000 livres. Paris wasn't the only city to suffer under raids and foreign invasions. In East Francia and Italy, the Magyars raided and pillaged the unprotected borderlands. On the Spanish peninsula, the Umayyad Caliphate invaded and at times got way into France. In the centuries prior to these invasions, the lands were relatively safe. Frankish counts that acted more like bureaucrats rather than nobility as we imagine it, lived in lavish yet relatively unprotected manors. The Frankish kings themselves didn't even have a true capital. They traveled between royal palaces referred to as Pfalzen, most famous of which is the one in Aachen, which was the favorite of Charlemagne, where you can visit his throne to this day. But despite having been extravagant palaces for the time, their defensive value was relatively low. And not unlike the Roman Empire before them, the early medieval people had to quickly adapt to the new threats they faced, constructing the first castles the Middle Ages are known for today. The Motte and Bailey Castle was the typical castle of the time, the most notable part being something the Romans never really thought of themselves. The tower, or keep, constructed out of wood and just sometimes out of stone, was positioned on elevated earthworks they flattened on top to make the position more defensible. This hill was called the Motte. The Bailey, on the other hand, was the fortification at the bottom of the hill, usually an enclosed courtyard surrounded by generally wooden high fence and a ditch. There was no ideal design, however, so they could vary. With the division of the Frankish kingdom into three parts, the government of the kings became way more decentralized, and power was privatized by the counts. The richer counts started the construction of castles on their own to protect their estates and property from raiders and fires, but primarily from other nobles that tried to conquer their estates through feuds. This privatization of government resulted in a boom in castle construction and a lot of innovation to surpass your neighbor's castle. Remember the Vikings I talked about earlier? Good. A few decades after Ragnar Lothbrok, a Viking named Rollo turned to France and raided the entire countryside. Instead of a few thousand coins like Ragnar, the Frankish king offered him the entire Duchy of Normandy as a ransom. Just 155 years later, his descendant, William the Bastard, invaded and conquered the Kingdom of England, and just like that, the Bastard turned into the Conqueror. Invading an entire kingdom doesn't come without resistance, of course. Immediately once William came ashore in England, he constructed a wooden castle to protect his army while raiding the countryside of England. This castle Hastings should only become the first of many castles William constructed in England once he became king. The most famous of William's castle is of course the Tower of London, or rather, the central keep called the White Tower. Hundreds of myths surround this castle and even more stories sprung out of the imagination of the people witnessing it. Considering the tower is a rather early construction right at the start of the so-called High Middle Ages, the keep is comparatively simple, but for the time it was a mighty fortress representing the king's power over the land. But it wasn't merely an object of prestige. Architecturally, the Tower of London was a stone keep castle, the most classic type of castle, the kind of fortress you think of when somebody talks about castles. These castles had a central keep, in this case the White Tower, surrounded by sturdy walls. The stone keep castles offered better defense as the earlier Motte and Baileys, as the keep was its own fortress to crack should the outer walls have fallen. In peace times, this type of castle offered more space for artisans, stables, and other tertiary buildings which were constructed within the castle. Ironically, the Tower of London's greatest defenses weren't constructed towards the countryside to face foreign invasions, but towards the city of London. The Tower of London served to exert power over his newly conquered city and the waterways of the Thames River, which in turn gave him control over the city's mercantile population. The Anglo-Saxon people continued to resist, and their resistance culminated in the Harrying of the North, a horrific campaign into northern England where William burned and pillaged the countryside to pacify it. Along the line, he constructed countless of castles that should serve as strong fortifications for his vassals to reside and exert power in. Those castles or their ruins continue to enrich the English countryside to this day. 30 years following William's conquest of England, as the Seljuk Turks became the new rulers in the Holy Land, Pope Urban II called for the First Crusade and the subsequent foundation of the Knightly Holy Orders. But as pious the Crusaders in the Holy Land were, they missed dozens of upcoming fantasy worldbuilding videos with historical and sociological foundations. So don't forget to subscribe, so you don't miss them either. The Order of Brothers of the German House of Saint Mary in Jerusalem, or more famously known as the Teutonic Order, is a knightly order founded in the Crusader city of Acre in 1191. The Teutonic Order was relatively late to the Club of Holy Orders, which means they were kicked out together with the other holy orders not that long after their foundation. After the order suffered another setback in Hungary, a Polish duke asked the Teutonic Order to help against the pagan population, and thus began the Prussian Crusade. Claiming the pagan land as their own, the Teutonic Order began constructing several castles in the area, including Marlborg Castle, or the Marienburg in German. This iconic red-bricked castle, constructed in the Gothic style typical for the Teutonic Order, is the largest traditional castle in the world. Like many other Crusader castles, like for example the famous Krak de Chevalier, Marlborg Castle is a concentric style castle. These types of castles arose through the advancement of siege technology in the Crusader states and had two main walls. The outer wall was usually lower than the inner one and protected the inner wall from advancing siege engines, while the inner wall served as ramparts for crossbowmen and later gunners. These concentric castles had more space, especially within their living quarters, which made it possible for them to house a large quantity of men for their army and to build large churches inside, like the Church of Mary, which is part of Marlborg Castle. The concentric type castles remained a relative rarity, however. They were rather expensive and thus only maintainable by the rich holy orders or by the kings of Europe. Other nobles had to be content with more affordable types of castles, like the earlier mentioned Stone Keep. In the end, the Teutonic Order faced a coalition of enemies that expelled them from Prussia, as their reign was tyrannical and brutal. But they left a large collection of castles for the Polish and Prussian nobility to move into. At the time, the Rhine River Valley boasted the largest collection of castles, however. You might assume that's because of the border with France, and that they served as fortification against the French enemy, but that wasn't really the case. Besides that the French border wasn't there at the time, the countless of nobles were fortifying against each other instead. The nobility loved to feud, but eventually the nobility only grew bored of living in musty old castles. In combination with further centralization of statehood, there was a new player on the block as well. In 1494, the Kingdom of France invaded the Italian peninsula, bringing the newest gunpowder technology with them. The old medieval fortifications of the many city-states were no match against these even stronger cannons, giving France an easy time in Italy, at least at first. The Italians adapted quickly with the invention of the Trans-Italienne, This new form of fortress construction, which means Italian outline in English, put heavy emphasis on the geometry of the fortress. So the cannonball's force gets either repelled by the angled earthworks or wall, or their force entirely absorbed. At first, these new fortifications were constructed along old cities or castle walls, but it didn't take that long until the kings of Europe employed many Italians to construct the new defensive weapon. And of course, this invention was soon built all over the world. In the typical bastion fort or star fort, as they were called for their star shape, were deadly obstacles for any army to pass. Kings required enormous armies to besiege these monstrosities. And the larger your army, the more you had to pay to sustain it. A single drawn-out siege could bankrupt a king, as it could take months, and in many cases years, to crack the speed bumps on the way to victory. This became the strategy of the New Age. In any region with a higher number of star fortresses, field battles became irrelevant. And the most drawn-out sieges even attracted tourists from all over Europe. To learn more about attacking and defending star fortresses, which is a science on its own, I'd recommend these two videos by Sand Roman History, as I would never do it remotely justice in a few sentences. Star fortresses weren't just a reaction to the evolution of warfare, however. With the increasing centralization of the state and the dramatic growth in available resources during the Renaissance and beyond, kings were able to field larger armies, which in turn required more efficient defenses to fight against. The Europeans weren't the only ones going through such a military evolution during the time. As with the arrival of the Portuguese in Japan, the warring samurais gained a new weapon to wield against their enemies. The Sengoku Jidai, the Warring States period of Japan, raged from 1467 to 1615. In these close to 150 years of constant warfare, the samurai were keen to get the ever so slightest edge over their enemies. Gunpowder, however, was a massive edge. One of these samurai was especially interested in the foreign weapons. Oda Nobunaga, the first of the three unifiers of Japan. He didn't appreciate gunpowder for its offensive capabilities alone. The famous general invented new ways of making Japanese castles into a death trap. During most of the Sengoku Jidai, castles were relatively simple, mostly wooden structures built on high ground. Oda Nobunaga took that concept and threw it away. He ordered his castles to be built upon large stone bases. The larger the individual rocks are, the more prestigious your castle was. He constructed several tiers of baileys, which each had a large gate. These baileys were used to trap the besieging army inside, so they could rain fire upon the intruders from slits at the tier above. For that, most walls had both arrow and gun slits, so the defenders could shoot while still being protected by the walls. Oda Nobunaga's new style of castles turned into an iconic image for Japan as a whole. Their actual relevancy in war was for a relatively short time, however. Oda Nobunaga died after having been betrayed by his retainer Akechi Mitsuhide, and after several more years of war, Tokugawa Ieyasu won at the Battle of Sekigahara and united all of Japan. With his victory, Tokugawa Ieyasu set in the Edo period of Japan and thus over 200 years of peace. During that period, castles turned into administrative buildings, former battlements and fortifications were turned into living quarters. But all these feudal lords didn't have to live all year in their castles anyway. Every daimyo had to live in the new capital of Edo, today's Tokyo, for half a year, where they were controlled by the shogun of the Tokugawa clan. But it's not like the daimyo had a bad life or anything. Each samurai had a massive mansion within Edo, a fate they shared with their French counterparts of the same age. We'll be right back. In 1661, King Louis XIV, the famous Sun King of France, began the construction of what would later become the most glorious and magnificent palace the world has ever seen. The Palace of Versailles, located just 19 kilometers outside of Paris, should become the center of politics not only for the Kingdom of France, but for all of Europe. King Louis XIV held up a similar policy to the previously mentioned Tokugawa Ieyasu. The king graciously invited the nobles of France to Versailles, where they were distracted with the pomp and intrigues of court while partying all day and night. The king used that distraction to centralize power upon him, appointing government positions by merit and make the state and bureaucracy more efficient. For that to be possible, Versailles had to be as magnificent as one can imagine. The entire estate had a gargantuan size of 800 hectares. To create the landscape of the palace garden, they drained an entire swamp. And to lay the waterworks and fountains, they redirected two entire rivers. The garden itself was a symbol of the king's control over even the wilderness, as the flowerbeds and shrubbery were famously geometric. Several other structures like ancient Greek theaters and colonnades, or several pavilions would be constructed to further enhance the garden, which turned into its own grandiose and magical world. The palace structure itself was split into three parts. In the center lay the royal apartments, where the king, his wife, and his many concubines lived. The famous Hall of Mirrors, the Baroque-style gallery that found its purpose as a symbol of power, lay here. The northern wing of the palace housed the high nobility of France, while the southern wing housed the closest family of the king, including the crown prince. There was an extra structure nearby housing the lower nobility of France as well. Versailles symbolized the might of France and the wealth and power of its absolutist king. And of course, many kings and nobles all around Europe tried to imitate such lavish displays of wealth. Hundreds of palaces sprouted out of the earth from Portugal to Russia, and in my vicinity alone I could tell you about several palaces without even getting into normal castles, and all of which was possible due to the slow emergence of modern statehood, coming with an unbeknownst efficiency in handling resources. Inspired by countless castles and palaces in Europe from past age, and Wagner's operas, the romanticist King Ludwig II of Bavaria had a clear vision when constructing Neuschwanstein Castle. For you to be similarly inspired when creating castles and palaces for your own fantasy world, I've got a set of questions you can ask yourself whenever you think about a palace or castle within your world. Luckily, as fantasy and real life shows, castles and palaces aren't mutually exclusive. You can construct magnificent palaces that are as fortified as any fortress after all. For castles and fortresses, think about the enemies the castle needs to repel and how a realistic defense would look like in your world. A world where fire-breathing dragons are common military enemies, castles might look more like bunkers or dwarven holds, or might be shored up with hundreds of harpoons to pull the lizards out of the sky. Magic is also an important factor, so think about how magical barriers and attacks might influence your castle's architecture. For palaces, think about their intrinsic purpose outside being a pompous residence. Palaces might house a multitude of other nobles and might be the center of government on top, while others are a mere distraction for their king, while matters of government are handled elsewhere. Next, think about how frequent castles and palaces are and how feasible they can be in your setting. In Europe, the number of castles exploded as the central government of the Franks collapsed and government turned more private, leading into countless of feuds between more minor nobles. Palaces, on the other hand, were built as government became more centralized again, as states began to emerge out of the feudal chaos when resources became easier to manage. Lastly, think about the style of your castle and palace, how they might look like visually. In fantasy, you shouldn't feel remorse to mix multiple architectural styles to fit your culture's needs. You shouldn't feel remorse to make your castle or palace as impossible as you need either. Just have a few answers at hand why the tower over there is thicker on the top than on the bottom. You should create the castle that fits your world and the story you're trying to tell as best as it can. Unlike Ludwig II of Bavaria, who faced intense scrutiny from numerous Bavarian nobles to the extent that he was deemed mentally unstable. Shortly after his diagnosis, Ludwig died. The exact circumstances of his death are unclear. He supposedly drowned himself in Lake Starnberg in Bavaria after taking a walk with his psychiatrist, who drowned himself with him. There are many conspiracy theories that claim Ludwig II was assassinated for political reasons by the Prussians, as he was fiercely against Prussian hegemony within the newly founded German Empire. The only reason Ludwig agreed to let Bavaria join the Empire has been Prussian funding to build his castles, after all, which nowadays at least attract millions of tourists and inspire countless of world builders by